Thank you, Jason. My opening statement is only about 5 minutes, so I'll give it three times. Good evening. Did you and I eat lunch together at Cafe Rio today? Yeah, okay. You look very familiar to the guy who was standing in line behind, so okay. Well, I'd like to welcome you to the University of Utah, the foundation started by Brigham Young. I only saw one heretical t-shirt here that said BYU somewhere, but we'll get through that at some point. I reluctantly accepted this invitation from Pastor Wallace, expecting that by the time this event took place that I would have been released as bishop. I didn't feel very comfortable about even a dialogue as a current serving bishop, but they asked me to extend my tenure a few months ago, and so I'm still here. So, you know, although I'm an administrator at the University of Utah and an instructor at the Institute of Religion and a bishop of an LDS ward, I don't represent the church or the university or the Institute of Religion. I'm here as a typical believing Mormon, I hope everybody's okay with that. The topic, as I understand it, is the Jesus of Mormonism biblical. I talked about that with my wife, and she said, "Say yes and sit down." Well, I'll go a little bit further than that and say that we accept everything that the Bible teaches about Christ and much more. Clearly, the answer to that question can vary depending on what your perspective of biblical is. I hate to bring in something as secular as this to say, what is the definition of is? But it sort of works the same way. What is the definition of biblical? I do enjoy participating in these types of discussions. I don't believe that they're particularly successful as an apologetic device, but I do find that I learn a lot from them. I think that you could have James White and me sit down in a room and close the doors, and we could talk our religious perspectives for days on end, and we would never come to an agreement of the minds. Almost like having, say me as Mitch McConnell and James White as Harry Reid, and have them, have them locked in a room and try to persuade each other to switch parties to Democrat or Republican. Their perspectives are very well entrenched. They know their particular positions, and it's doubtful that they will be dissuaded. But I think they can learn from each other. I suspect that tonight our discussion will cover a lot of ground. My experience in these types of discussions shows that we go from topic to topic to topic because they are all interrelated. I think there is a tendency among a lot of Latter-day Saints to say, you know, we're not as bad as you say we are. We believe a lot that you believe. I'm hesitant to say that because our perspectives of the nature of God, the nature of man, the nature of Scripture, the nature of a host of objects is significantly different than what you find in evangelical Christianity. But I think what is consistent is that we believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, that He came to earth, He lived a perfect life, He died on the cross, He died for the sins of the whole world. He died for me. He died for you. He rose again the third day, and He ascended again into heaven. And that the fundamental principles of our religion are the testimony of the apostles and prophets concerning Christ, that He lived, that He died for our sins, and rose again the third day. Everything else that we might talk about are merely appendages to that most important message. Thank you.
Well, Alma should know I will probably take all 15 minutes, probably 14 minutes and 59 seconds approximately. That's just sort of how I do things. I really do appreciate the opportunity of being with you here this evening. I've done more than 150 debates. I just did a debate down in South Africa not long ago in a mosque and things like that. But I've never debated one of the three Nephites before. And now that's a test of how many people in here even know who the three Nephites are. That's when I first met Alma outside the south gate of the temple during a general conference, both of us looked a lot differently than we do now. We were trying to figure out when that first happened. It was very early on back, well, I'm afraid where a number of you in this room had not even come into existence yet. We're figuring about 28 years ago, if it was 1988-ish, somewhere around there. So it's been a while, and our correspondence was extensive. I'm glad to know that you still have that. I probably do somewhere too. I just have no earthly idea where. That's the problem. I would love to have reviewed some of it, though I do remember a lot of it. We go back a long, long ways, and we discussed many, many things. I remember walking around during the general conference, and I don't want to give too many things away, but for example, it was Alma who said, you know, if you had special glasses that would allow you to see how many polygamists there are walking around here right now, you'd be shocked. And I've always wanted to have those special glasses. I'm not sure if he has them or not, but it'd be very useful as a bishop to have special glasses like that. But we also had, I remember a discussion as we were walking around during conference about one of the key issues this evening. And that is, for example, Alma just said, we believe Jesus is the Son of God. Well, what does that mean? Obviously, if you believe in the fact that there is only one true and eternal God, who has eternally been God, there are no gods before him, there will be no gods after him, then the relationship of Father and Son becomes an eternal relationship. It is not a relationship that involves a wife, begettal in the sense of derivation, any of those things like that. And as I was studying Mormonism many, many, many years ago, that was one of the issues that came up. And in fact, in my book, Is the Mormon My Brother?, one of the chapters was on what historically the concept of Jesus as the only begotten of the Father in the flesh meant, as it was explained by the apostles and prophets of the LDS Church. And yet you'll find a huge amount of difference about that today, and yet we had discussions about that many, many decades ago. One of the things that I'm hoping will be clarified this evening, how do you define what the LDS position is today? My focus has moved away. I mean, the 1980s, I was very focused upon reading a tremendous amount of LDS literature and interacting with folks like Alma and Eldon Watson and other people like that electronically back before the internet. That was on BBSs. How many of you know what a BBS is? Ah, you're a bunch of old fogies. So, BBSs were how we were communicating. That was my focus at the time, and since then, especially right now, I'm doing a lot of work in the area of Islam and a lot of work in the area of the textual criticism of the New Testament, and so I'm not able to keep up with all the developments, but I know one thing. I still have dialogues with Mormons once in a while, and things have changed a lot since the 1980s. I mean, in the 1980s, I could walk up to 12-year-old kids, and they would defend the idea of a plurality of gods and things like that. Now you have to carry the entire LDS library on your iPad to read them to adults, because so many of them, well, we've never believed anything like that. What are you talking about? There's huge changes taking place. So one of the things I hope during our conversation together is to talk about the fact that from my perspective, it seems like things have changed a lot, and I'm really wondering what the direction is going to be as far as there are so many things that we used to talk about in regards to Mormonism that I would have to carry this big notebook around with photocopies of stuff that now is being printed by Deseret Book. A lot of things have changed over the past three decades, and I think it's been accelerating recently. And I'm not the only one wondering, well, what is this all going to lead to? And so in regards to our subject this evening, as Alma mentioned, this is going to end up talking, we're going to end up having to talk about a lot of things. Why? Well, we have to figure out what is official LDS doctrine. I know Bruce R. McConkie thought he knew what LDS official LDS doctrine is, but now every Mormon missionary I talk to thinks that he was just a little bit on the loony side. So what do we do about that? And it all comes back to what we believe in regards to what God has revealed. And when I wrote Is the Mormon My Brother, I tried to really be very careful as to the sources of Mormon authority and putting them in a proper order as to how to look at these things. But there's always been levels of disagreement. And so when we're talking about who Jesus is, are we talking about that subject from the good old days of Mormon doctrine, where the Council of Nicaea is the whisperings of Satan? Or today, where there's much more of a, well, I sense a sort of ecumenical spirit amongst many people in the leadership of the church, where you're not having quite that clear a statement. Do we still believe amongst the Mormons that there is a need for an authority to define these things? Priesthood authority? Did the Christian church completely cease to exist until it was restored April 6, 1830? Do you have to have the Aaronic and Melchizedek priesthoods? The issue, I've literally, and I don't know what Alma would think about this, but I've literally had conversations with Mormons recently, electronically, who've come into our old-style chat channel, and pretty much everything I brought up, they'd go, oh, yeah, you know, well, you need to understand the first vision, you know, yeah, there were different versions because there was evolution in the story, and you know, it was Joseph Smith's spiritual experience, and, you know, his recollection of it changed over time, and yeah, the earliest versions, there wasn't a plurality of gods that comes along later, and yeah, that seer stone thing, and, you know, and I'm just blown away because everything that I used to talk to Mormons about, where I would have here's your position, here's my position, let's talk about truth. So many of those things that with that kind of a Mormon, I didn't even know what to say. Because it was all just, well, you know, this is my experience, and I learned things from looking at the lives of prophets, but I realized that they were imperfect, and some of these things developed over time. And what's amazing to me is I went to a seminary for my first master's degree, Fuller Theological Seminary, which is way to my left. And as I'm listening to these folks, I'm going, I've heard this before. But what I've heard, where I've heard it was from liberal Protestants who had abandoned any type of biblical faith and were sort of holding this modernized version together. And I'm like, I don't, how does that work when you're claiming that Joseph Smith was a prophet and that And it's so plain and clear when you read all the way up through the 1980s that if he wasn't what he claimed to be, then this whole thing isn't true. And now it's just sort of like, well, maybe not, you know. These are some of the questions, the issue of authority, where we derive our religious beliefs. And if Alma and I get together 10 years from now, will we be saying the same things? I think those are important issues. Obviously, from my perspective, I think I will be saying the same things. And what will I be saying? Well, if we go back to those letters that we wrote long, long time ago, I think I've been pretty consistent all along. The reason that I have sought to speak to Mormons all along is because I believe that there is only one true God. And I believe that he's revealed himself in such a way that the Bible teaches that Jesus Christ is God incarnate. He is the Word made flesh. But the foundation of that recognition is first and foremost the Shema. Shema Yisrael Yahweh Eloheinu Yahweh Echad. Hear, O Israel, Yahweh is our God. Yahweh is one. Yahweh is Elohim. There is no distinction between Yahweh and Elohim, Jehovah and Elohim in the Old Testament. There is only one true and eternal God. And the Father is identified as Yahweh. The Son is identified as Yahweh. The Spirit is Yahweh. They're not one person. Jesus isn't a ventriloquist. He isn't casting his voice up to heaven. But that one name of Yahweh describes the one being of God who has eternally been God. He says in Psalm 90, verse 2, before the mountains were brought forth, wherever thou hast formed the earth and the world, even from everlasting to everlasting, you are God. That is the profession of the people of God. And as I first encountered LDS missionaries back in 1982, and I began reading A Marvelous Work and a Wonder and Teachings of Prophet Joseph Smith and Mormon Doctrine and Articles of Faith and so on and so forth. Once I finally read from the King Follett Funeral Discourse, Joseph Smith saying, we have imagined and supposed that God was God from all eternity. I refute that idea and take away the veils that you may see. To me, that is where the division exists. The most fundamental issue of religion is whether you believe that there is one true and eternal God who created all things or whether you don't. There is no more basic level to which you can go. And it is on that level that we have always been divided. And so we use a lot of the same terminology. We make reference to a lot of the same things. But if there is that fundamental difference, then everything else after that ends up changing. We talk about Son of God. We believe that's a relationship without any mother, without any wife, without any God having lived upon another planet and become exalted to the status of godhood, and without the idea that God has a body of flesh and bones as tangible as any man. It's a very, very, very different perspective, and it is the one that goes back to the apostles and not back to, well, I was going to say April 6, 1830, but I think you can argue that that was a development that came along even after April 6, 1830. And so how do we discuss these things? Hopefully we do so with mutual respect. We do so recognizing that, almost said, well, you know, if we sat in the same room together for all that time, we'd probably never change each other's minds. Well, if what you mean by that is that I am insufficient as an arguer to out-argue you, you're probably exactly right. But see, the wonderful thing, Jason and I are not part of the same denomination, but we have a whole lot in common. In fact, I've always said the two denominations are the most alike, are Reformed Baptist and OPC. We share a common theology, and that is, of course I can't convince you. It's not possible. I don't have the ability to change hearts and minds. I can't reach in and change someone's spiritual nature. But we do believe that the Word of God is alive and powerful. The Spirit of God still continues to draw people to His truth. And so we continue to speak that truth. And I would like nothing better than to have unity with someone as kind and nice as Alma Allred. He's a much nicer guy than I am, okay? If the debate and dialogue is based upon who's nicest, I might as well leave right now, because anybody who knows me knows, it's just that he's Scottish. Oh, sorry. That's why Jason and I both get along, because we both swing claymores at each other. But niceness isn't what determines truth. And as much as I would love to have meaningful unity with someone like Alma Allred, I think we both agree unity has to be based upon a conviction of truth. And there are absolutely fundamental differences between us, because I believe that Jesus Christ created all things, anything that exists anywhere. Colossians chapter 1 says, for by him were all things made, whether in heaven and earth, visible and invisible, principalities, powers, dominions, authorities, all things created by him and for him. He is before all things, and in him all things exist. I cannot put that worldview together with the King Follett Funeral Discourse. And as long as that discourse continues to have a doctrinal, definitional role within LDS theology, and from my perspective, the day it doesn't, you no longer have Mormonism. I don't know what you call what you've got, but it's no longer Mormonism. As long as that stands as the ultimate authority, then we are using a different lexicon. We may be using the same words, but we mean very, very, very different things. And why then is that important? Because the scriptures warn us against false Jesuses. The true Jesus is the one who can save. And there are all sorts of false Jesuses today. And so this is not just an academic exercise. This is something that's vitally important. It has to do with the gospel. It has to do with how we show love for one another. And I'm very appreciative for Alma being here and for all of you being here this evening. Let's have a good conversation together.
I did want to make a couple of comments, just responding. He referred to me as one of the three Nephites. That comes from a thing that happened about 35 years ago. I took my kids hiking up in the High Uintas, and I found a lost scout. And I hiked him back to Camp Steiner, and they had been looking for him for the whole day, and they'd gathered the whole camp in for prayer. And I showed up as soon as the prayer broke up and turned him over to the first adult I saw, and then I took off. And they said, "Who found you?" And he said, "It was some guy with a beard named Nephi or Alma." They thought, "Whoa! It was one of the three Nephites." And it made it in the newspaper and everything else like that. So it's
Actually, I had never heard that story before. All I know is the white hair makes him look like one of the three Nephites.
I thought you were telling it. Okay. I have to disagree a bit with James about the changes that he's seeing. I think that you may have seen somewhat of a retrenchment of less likely to be talking some of the more esoteric doctrines, such as plurality of gods. But they're there. They're in our scriptures. I've heard people say, "Well, you know, you Mormons, you didn't used to claim to be Christian." We've always claimed to be Christian. I can give you a quotation from any one of our publications going back from 1832 to today. We have always claimed to be Christian. We believe in a plurality of gods. And I think that James's perspective of that monotheism is the fundamental issue is an effort by on his part to do presentism, to impose upon history what he perceives has been always the case. There is a lot of historical documentation that shows that anciently the Hebrews were not strictly monotheists. There is a lot of historical documentation that the early Christians were not strict monotheists. If you don't believe me, there are Christian authors, Margaret Barker wrote a fascinating book. She's written 8 or 9 books, but the one that I find most fascinating in this regard is called The Great Angel, A Study of Israel's Second God. I have talked with Hebrew scholars who say that the ideas of monotheism, strict monotheism among Hebrews, did not start until the Middle Ages. And that the ancient Hebrews, the patriarchs, believed in a religion that is very similar and very compatible with Mormonism. Now, I continue to teach plurality of gods. I have never even considered that that may be something that we're breaking away from. I teach the same doctrine in my institute classes today that I proposed to James White 30 years ago. I do not see that change taking place. I see the necessity of the church to dial down some of the rhetoric because we are faced with 300,000-400,000 new converts every year. And it is not wise to give meat to babes. They need to be comfortable with the primary doctrines of the gospel. We will not shy away from it. There is no topic that is off the table in any of my institute classes, and there never has been. So that is one thing. I also, James and I have gone around and around about this. I concur with him that anciently, if you read the Hebrew Bible, that the terms Elohim and Jehovah are interchangeable, that the designations that exist in the LDS Church are a matter of convenience, not theology. I can refer to Jehovah in our scriptures, in Sunday school classes, and everyone will say, "Oh, you're talking about Christ." I say, "Well, no, actually, that's an artificial distinction that we have made." There are passages in the Old Testament that talk about Jehovah Elohim. It's the same individual. But I will also say that Christ stepped forward with the name of his Father in his authority, and he became known as Jehovah in the Old Testament. And it is entirely proper to refer to either the Father or the Son as either Jehovah or Elohim. Linguistically, culturally, since 1914 or 1918, There was an exposition on the Father and the Son, where the church designated, when we refer to Elohim, we're talking about the Father. When we refer to Jehovah, we're referring to the Son. But those are not hard and fast rules, particularly linguistically.
Well, so many things there, but it is a basic fundamental issue, what we believe about God. And now it's been very straightforward. I do not believe in the plurality of gods, and I do not believe that that is a biblical doctrine. So let's talk about what is biblical. You can find all sorts of publications today from all sorts of scholars that will argue that what you have in the Bible is an evolutionary document, where the Israelites start at one place, this one book will have this perspective. Of course, most Old Testament faculties in the world today will teach the JEDP theory, the Yahwist, the Elohist, the Deuteronomist, the priestly theory, where the Old Testament is cobbled together from various and sundry contradictory sources. And so, yes, you can find all sorts of scholarship today that will say that during this period, Israel showed this kind of perspective or that kind of perspective. If you take the perspective of the Old Testament that Jesus had, and if you believe the Scriptures cannot be broken, and if you believe, as Paul taught, that all Scripture is theanoustos, that all of it is profitable for rebuke, correction, for training, righteousness, for doctrine, for teaching. If you take Peter's perspective, that men spoke, what they spoke came from God, and they spoke as they were carried along by the Holy Spirit. So in other words, if you have a thoroughly Christian doctrine of inspiration, then this atomizing of the Old Testament text and cutting it up into little pieces and putting one part in opposition to another part simply isn't an option for you any longer. And so when I say that the people of God historically have been monotheists, then those texts in the Old Testament where God has eternally been God, he did not become a God. There were no gods before him. There will be no gods after him. Where you have the affirmation of the fact that he knows of no other deities. And then you have the revelation in the New Testament where that one name of Yahweh, the one God who creates all things in the Old Testament, reveals himself as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Yet you have a distinction between Father, Son, and Spirit where the Son speaks to the Father speaks to the Father and the Son send the Holy Spirit. This is why I have said that the early church were experiential Trinitarians. Peter had heard the Father speak. He had walked with the Son. He was now indwelt by the Holy Spirit. And yet they still believe that Shema Yisrael, Yahweh Eloheinu, Yahweh Echad. So one of the things we have to deal with is, what is biblical? When we say the deity of Christ, the Mormon view of Jesus, what is biblical? We live in a day where, again, you might say, I'm just missing all of this, but it seems to me, Alma, that there has been a lot of influx into Mormon academia of concepts and academic insights that were not a part of the Mormon experience, say, up through the 1960s, and that is impacting the way in which things are taught and the interaction between Mormonism and the rest of the world. I mean, wouldn't you say that BYU was a pretty self-contained, not a whole lot of tremendous interaction with the rest of the world up until, 60s, 70s?
I would suggest in the early 60s that there was a change in perhaps policy that was driven by David O. McKay to make the church more of a worldwide church. We had, I think, withdrawn a little bit from society at large because of our poverty, because of our isolation.
Intermountain West.
Intermountain West, and that there was an effort by David O. McKay to broaden the perspective, increase its academic footprint, BYU became, and I think before that time, you didn't have professors of Greek with degrees from North Carolina, from Princeton. You had guys who went to Utah State University, the right. University of Utah. Nothing negative about the University of Utah, but there wasn't the academic timber that you see today at BYU. I think that's a given.
But here's a question I wanted to get to, and I see these things as fundamental before we can really get to the thesis, and that is, you just mentioned some books in regards to henotheism, and again, I went to Fuller, so this is stuff that I was encountering a long time ago. But if you bring that kind of perspective, which starts with, we will look at any claimed supernatural text first and foremost as a naturalistic text. We're gonna ask the question, did it evolve? What sources did it evolve from? All that kind of stuff. That's where this type of scholarship is coming from, to where the Old Testament scholarship you're talking about would be very deeply focused upon dependence of the Hebrew scriptures upon previous Canaanite religious writings and so on and so forth, and drawing history of religions theory. If that's brought into Utah, and this is where I'm seeing some of this thing in my mind anyways, correct me if I'm wrong, but if that's brought into Utah,
okay, and you're applied, wrong.
Okay, thank you. We can all go home now. But if that's applied to the LDS scriptures, if that's applied especially to the Book of Mormon, or if it's applied to the Book of Abraham, that's going to have a huge impact, because now you have to start saying, okay, Joseph Smith was using these sources, and you have to go back to going, well, where did Joseph Smith get these ideas about the ancient Israelites in America? And you have to give automatic first and primary credence to what sources he was drawing from, not the idea that there were golden plates written in Reformed Egyptian hieroglyphics.
I don't think that's the case, because what you're talking about is, from the outset of Mormonism, is a miraculous arrival of the gold plates. You're not talking about a miraculous arrival of the Old Testament. There's historical information. In fact, I'm a little reluctant to bring up Bart Ehrman, but Bart Ehrman was a dedicated evangelical conservative until he realized what the evidence was. The evidence showed that the Old Testament and the New Testament were not what he always thought they were. That does not create a problem for Mormonism. I don't think that there's any problem in Mormonism that you have a couple of thousand varying manuscripts of the Old Testament and the New Testament. The fact that they're different is not a problem. Our perspective of Scripture is different than your perspective of Scripture. I don't have any problem with Moses writing the first five books of the Bible and saying, you know, I'm familiar with the book of Job from my time in the land of Canaan. I'm going to put this in the sacred writ. It's a true story. I'm going to include it. There are some biblical scholars who believe that that's the source of the book of Job. I don't have a problem with that.
I didn't follow that last section there, but since you brought up Bart Ehrman, there's a couple problems there. I won't get into the... I just did a series of lectures on Ehrman and the errors in Ehrman's teachings at Northwest University in Potchefstroom, South Africa. And he and I have debated. And he does not say what you just said was his actual exodus. He specifically says that he left Christianity because of the problem of evil, not because of the issue of the text.
Actually, that's one of the three. I have his quote here.
Right. But he had come to the conclusion of issues regarding the text while he remained as a practicing pastor. It was the issue of evil that caused him to become an agnostic. But even at that, his field of study is not Old Testament. And right. Secondly, in regards to the New Testament, he would admit that the New Testament is the most anciently attested document we have from that time period, the most widely attested document from that time period, and the best attested as far as the purity of the text. So you have to remember there's a difference between the Bart Ehrman who writes the books that sell a lot of copies and the Bart Ehrman that writes the books that he then has to defend within the scholarly community. There's a difference between the two, and that's one of my problems with him. But the point is, I do think that if you bring a Bart Ehrman perspective into the Book of Mormon, you're now going to be comparing the changes that have been made in the Book of Mormon. You're going to be looking at the Doctrine and Covenants, and you're going to be looking at the 1833 Book of Commandments.
There's not a problem with that. From our perspective, we don't have a problem with...
But from Bart Ehrman's perspective, you can't go, the reason that over 400 words have been added or deleted from this one revelation, including the doctrine of the priesthood, is because someone had the Melchizedek priesthood and the authority to do that. That's not something that Bart Ehrman allows into the scholarly equation, any more than he would allow me to say that the reason that you should accept what John 1:18 says is because the Holy Spirit of God has protected his scriptures over time. That is a presupposition that that form of scholarship will not allow. And the idea of a divine priesthood or a leadership of a prophet, it can't go there. That cannot be a part of that means of scholarship. And so my question is, if you apply that, it's going to have a fundamentally corrosive effect long term. And if the leadership of the church is derived from BYU and things like that...
Okay, I would say that that's a spurious conclusion. Because first of all, our scriptures are not dependent upon scholarly endeavors. Our doctrine will not change because of the conclusion, which we have always recognized, that Joseph Smith added passages to scriptures from revelations that he had. We don't perceive scripture the way you do or the way Bart Ehrman does. And the reason I brought up Bart Ehrman is because he came to the conclusion that the scriptures did not exist as he always believed that they did.
Well, let me just point out, Bart Ehrman has, his fundamental assertion is, and I don't know how we got on this, but very quickly, his fundamental assertion is, if God inspired it, there would never be any changes in it.
And that's and when he found it was a mistake.
But that was never even, that's not what was taught at any of the schools he went to.
Yeah.
So.
Well, and I think he's right there.
You think he's right there?
Well, I think he found it troubling to find out that there were changes, still believing that God had inspired it. Now, from the Latter-day Saint perspective, that's not a problem.
But from a classical Christian perspective, that's not a problem either. He had a misunderstanding. The idea that God will not allow a copyist to make an error in copying a manuscript 300 years after the days of Jesus. What's he going to do? Strike him dead before he misspells a word? You know, all of a sudden he goes up into flames or something like that? I mean, the whole idea that he had was one of ignorance. And it's not one that, if you read the early church fathers, they did not hold the position that Ehrman had assumed. So he was ignorant. And then when his ignorance was discovered, then he went the other direction into agnosticism. My whole point is this. When we talk about who Jesus is, from a biblical perspective, if you apply some of the scholars you've already cited to either of our scriptures, we can never define the term biblical. Any more than you could define anything consistently from the Book of Mormon, Doctrine, Covenants, Great Price, because they are going to look at it, take out the supernatural element. You can't talk about Joseph Smith as a prophet. You have to look at these books, and you have to find out what the natural sources were.
But that's not going to happen in Mormonism. And whether BYU, which I, you know, as a Ute fan, I'm reluctant to cast them as the leaders of academia, but those leaders of academia are not bringing into the situation. So we've been reevaluating how the Bible was compiled. We're not reevaluating how the Book of Mormon came about. Now, clearly we have a different perspective. Joseph Smith had no problem with revising the Book of Mormon.
Right.
I don't have any problem with that.
From Bart Ehrman's perspective, that means it's not inspired.
Yeah. Unfortunately, he doesn't understand how inspiration works.
I agree.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay.
So we just dismissed Bart Ehrman. All
okay.
Right.
So we can go home.
I'm sensing a few people in the audience saying the same thing here. You're saying there cannot be a change. There will not be a change. But you have living prophets who can change the emphasis. You admitted that, and in fact, I found this very strange. You said, well, we have all these converts. We're not going to feed them meat. We need to give them milk first. You were having many, many converts in the 1980s, and every missionary I talked to outside that building right down there in downtown Salt Lake City was smack dab on top of what you now call esoteric doctrine. Those were the very first things they brought up to me. So if you had all those converts then, I mean, I used to tell the story that during some period in the 1980s, on an average week, 274 Southern Baptists became Mormons, and the average Southern Baptist church had 273 members.
Yes.
So I don't think those numbers have remained constant during time, but the point is, why would it be different now? You were having lots of converts then, and the young people that I talked to knew what the issues were. I mean, they knew that Joseph Smith said it is the first principle of the gospel to know for certainty the character of God, and that we may converse with him as one man converses with another, that God himself is one another. They knew that. They could quote that.
That hasn't changed.
It has in my experience. In my experience, I mean, just one of the most recent conversations I had was, interestingly enough, in a ward chapel. We actually met in the ward chapel right in front of the pulpit. Three missionaries and two other people. And Alma, I couldn't get them to talk about doctrine or who God was or the first principle of the gospel if I had whipped out a wad of cash and paid them to do it. They would not do it.
I had the same problem. I had two missionaries living in our basement, and they would not eat blue cheese, even if I offered to pay them.
Well, maybe the fact that you had them trapped in your basement has something to do with it, but I'm not sure how they weren't missed. But anyway, I sense a huge difference over
time.
Well,
I'll tell you, you gave that quote. I believe that I gave that exact quote from the pulpit in my ward in the last 3 months.
I would assume that that has to continue to happen, but the emphasis seems to have changed. And I'm just trying to identify what the sources of it are, because we can't, you know, we've presented two very different. Would you agree with me that we do not believe in the same Jesus?
No. I would say that we believe different things about Jesus Christ, but I would say that we don't believe the things that you believe about him, the traditional Jesus. I would agree with that. I would agree with President Hinckley, who said that.
So if I said Alma Allred is actually a 4'7" Italian man with dark hair who can barely speak English.
Allora, parliamo.
You would say we're still talking about the same person?
Now, what I would say is you may say that as a typical example, that President Obama is the best president we've ever had.
Somebody have any water?
Or someone may tell you that Obama is the best president you've ever had, and you may think that he's not. You're not thinking about two different Obamas.
That is true, but I see a fundamental difference here. That, to be honest with you, I think on this point, I think McConkie might have agreed with me, not you, on this.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not going to force you to take a position on that. But I really, why did Paul warn about a false Jesus?
Because there was the possibility of people following someone who was not, did not have the power to save.
How different does that Jesus have to be to qualify as a different Jesus?
I think that's a good question, and I think that the answer is evident by the day of Pentecost. People came to salvation, they accepted Christ as their Savior, they entered into the kingdom of God with very little knowledge about the exact characteristics of Jesus Christ, other than that he had died for their sins and that he was resurrected. Everything else beyond that was tangential to their religion?
Tangential in the sense that when the apostles, because it goes on to say that they daily were being instructed by the apostles.
That's right.
Do you think one of those people, if they then rejected what the apostles taught, would be considered to be a part of the family of God and of the church of God?
No, I don't think they would. But also, I wouldn't agree that if they did not accept the idea that... I'm trying to think of something that would be innocuous, and I can't. That by rejecting something the apostles taught, that automatically concluded that they were worshiping a different Jesus.
So, Jehovah's Witnesses. Jesus is Michael the Archangel, the first and greatest of God's creation.
Yeah, that's a mistake.
Mistake or a different Jesus?
Well, what they believe about him is wrong.
But can Michael the Archangel save you?
No.
So that would be crossing a line that would mean that no matter how strong the profession of that, no matter how sincere or emotional the profession of faith of that person, Michael the Archangel still isn't going to save you.
That's correct.
You don't see the difference that you and I have as being of the same nature as that?
Well, I would say that I don't believe that you will be saved in your current circumstance, the current perspectives you have about God, because I believe that they are mistaken.
Saved in the sense of exalted.
Either way, same thing.
Well, again, we're using words in different ways.
When the scriptures talk about salvation, they're referencing, by and large, exaltation.
From reading the New Testament within the context of the...
From the Mormon perspective.
From the Mormon perspective, as I was saying.
When it talks about salvation, it means exaltation in the celestial kingdom.
Okay. So, I obviously believe that the New Testament apostles had no concept of a God who had lived on another planet as a man.
And you can be a Mormon and not have that concept either, because I've never taught it.
You've never taught it.
We do not teach. That is an extension, a logical extension of what we believe.
That has been taught by apostles and prophets of the LDS Church.
As a logical extension. But it is not strictly gospel doctrine, doctrine of the church. The doctrine of the church is what is found in the standard works.
So if God has a body of flesh and bones, if God the Father has a body of flesh and bones, tangible as any man's.
Right. That's in our scriptures.
That's in the scriptures.
Yeah.
That doesn't get interpreted in the light of the constant repetition of the King Follett funeral discourse in Latter-day Revelation?
Sure. That is extra-canonical. You don't have to believe it. You can be a faithful Latter-day Saint and say, I don't accept the King Follett discourse. But if you are a faithful Latter-day Saint, you are under covenant to accept the standard works as doctrines of the church. And in fact, I mean, there are lots of doctrines that I can postulate about. In fact, you know, I do. In my institute class, I will say, someone will ask a question, and I will say, okay, this is not gospel doctrine, this is Alma. Not the Alma from the Book of Mormon, this is Alma from your teacher. This is my explanation. It is not necessarily doctrinal. It may be true, it may not be. In fact, I like to say, I tell my class, half of what I tell you is true, and you have to decide which half it is.
So the repeated emphasis to me from Latter-day Saints over decades now, that the great superiority of the certainty of the Mormon is found in the fact that we have living prophets and apostles that can, unlike us, who are just stuck with a written text, can provide inspired interpretation. It almost sounds like you're going, nah, but we're sola scriptura. Because the King Follett discourse is probably the single most, I checked this out once I may not have the most up-to-date version of whatever the newest software is, but I've had it in the past. I have a feeling the King Follett discourse is the most repeated statement from Joseph Smith, from all of the apostles and prophets of the Mormon Church down over the past hundred and however many years you know has been digitized and all the rest of that stuff. And so if his statement that this is the first principle of the gospel, which is then repeated over and over again, not only by the apostles and prophets, but then in the teaching material of the church, Corporation of the First Presidency of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, meant to be used for the instruction of the LDS people, if that isn't normative, then what could be normative?
I'm not saying that it's not normative. I'm saying that it is not required for belief.
But how could you believe truly and accurately if you reject what the consistent interpretation of the LDS scriptures by the LDS leadership has been for 180 years, 90 years now?
There are a lot of doctrines, or there are a lot of concepts that are true that are not part of our canon.
Canon scripture?
Our scripture.
There's a difference between canon and dogma.
Yeah.
So,
part of our canon.
Okay, temple ceremonies. Can you reject them?
No. Because,
but they're not in the scriptures.
Well, I would say, I'm trying to be clear here. I teach in my classes, and I have for years, that LDS doctrine is that which can be easily demonstrated by the standard works, the teachings of the temple, and the bona fide statements of the prophet Joseph Smith. Now, there are...
King Follett's not bona fide teachings of the prophet Joseph Smith?
It's not entirely accurate. I mean, there were four different versions, and what we get is a conglomeration of the four different versions. If the brethren wanted to canonize it, they could, but they haven't. Now, that tells you something about its status within the church. There are doctrines that have been canonized in my lifetime. That is not one of them.
Slightly off topic, you can be very brief if you would, but if Bruce R. McConkie were sitting in the front row, would he agree with what you just said concerning the King Follett discourse?
I believe he would. Let me give you an example. This is from Harold B. Lee when he was president of the church. He said, "If anyone, regardless of his position in the church, were to advance a doctrine that is not substantiated by the standard church works, meaning the Bible, the Book of Mormon, the Doctrine and Covenants, and the Pearl of Great Price, you may know that his statement is merely his private opinion. The only one authorized to bring forth any new doctrine is the president of the church, who, when he does, will declare it as revelation from God, and it will be so accepted by the Council of the Twelve and sustained by the body of the church. And if any man speak a doctrine which contradicts what is in the standard church works, you may know that by that same token it is false, and you are not bound to accept it as truth."
But the interpretation of those standard works is still provided by the living voice,
if
right?
If it's consistent with the standard works. Now, going back to what you said, that God was once a mortal on a planet, you do not find that in our standard works.
But you find it taught by apostles and prophets.
Yeah, as a logical extension of the doctrine.
Okay, so if the idea is that you can become a god,
mm-hmm. which is in our standard works,
then we can understand why it has been taught that that's what God experienced as well.
That is a possible conclusion. However, our scriptures never postulate a time when God was not God. The King Follett discourse does, but it isn't canonized. There is nothing in our scriptures even that says Christ was not God.
Eternally.
Yeah, there is nothing in our scriptures that says that Christ was not God. Anytime you have a reference point in any of our scriptures, Jesus Christ is God.
So the Son of God, you could believe, had eternally been God.
I couldn't, but I think you might. A Mormon might.
You couldn't.
I couldn't.
Why
no.
can't you?
I don't think it's consistent with reality.
With reality.
Yeah. I don't think that it is reasonable or logical to call someone a son who always was son.
So temporality, you insist on a temporality in the experience of
God.
Well,
I conclude in my own mind that there is a time when Jesus Christ became the Son.
So when the Psalter says, before the mountains were brought forth, or ever thou hast formed the earth and the world, even from everlasting to everlasting, thou art God.
Not a problem with that.
You don't have a problem with that.
No, because I have a reference point that is everlasting from everlasting. The Hebrew term olam, mm-hmm. it's horizon to horizon. Essentially, as far back as you can perceive this direction to as far back, far forward in this perspective, he has been God.
But there may have been something before that.
It is outside of our understanding.
So how could, in Hebrew, true eternal existence have been expressed if that isn't the phrase?
Good question. I don't know.
Okay. So,
sorry to give you a Gil Sharps.
When we talk about Jesus, then, you're saying that there are multiple ways within Mormonism that you could appropriately understand who he is?
Absolutely. I think that there are as many perspectives of who Christ is and what he is like as there probably are people. I've found that in speaking with evangelical Christians. I would be surprised to sit down with two evangelical Christians and have them give me the same understanding of the Trinity.
Well, I certainly wouldn't be. Uh-huh. Having written a book that's used as a textbook across the United States on the Trinity, I would hope that the people who read that would sort of come up with the same conclusion.
But I think they have different perspectives.
Who had that book in here? I signed a book earlier. Was it your book that I signed? Okay. I have a feeling we'd probably actually believe the same thing about the doctrine of the Trinity. But it's sounding like, from what you're saying, is because the interpretation of the apostles and prophets cannot be considered dogma, that there could be variety of understanding. So all those missionaries that I spent hours and hours talking to in Salt Lake City and in Mesa, who were absolutely certain that Jesus Christ could not have created all things because his father had to have a planet to live on when he was a man, they were just involved in esoteric doctrine, and that really, they shouldn't have been wasting their time on
that. If you will remember our discussions, I believe that when it says that Christ created all things, that there is a limit to that. And you even pointed out to me that all doesn't necessarily mean all.
Not in that context, I didn't.
Well, you do, but you picked the context.
In fact,
but
I
you
said,
picked the context.
No, in fact, I said the exact opposite. I said there are many places in Scripture where all has a limited meaning. But in Colossians chapter 1, Paul exhausts the utilization of Greek prepositions. For by him were all things made, whether in heaven or in earth, visible, invisible, principalities, powers, dominions, thrones, authorities, all things are created by him and for him. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together. That is a man trying to make sure that everyone understands that I'm talking about the creator of all things.
Okay.
So I make... So you're right when I said that in some context, when it says all of Jerusalem went out to John the Baptist,
that's not true.
I have a feeling that there was probably somebody left in Jerusalem during that time period. So obviously there are contexts. But Colossians chapter 1, the context exactly goes in the opposite direction because of what Paul's responding to at that point. That is so kind of someone. Those even look cold.
Hey, thanks.
Okay.
I wish I could say it was me.
Thank you.
Yes, thank you. Cold water given, and there's something in the Bible about that. So, I'm not sure where we are, Jason, in our time frame. I knew we would be discussing these things. Well, and Jason no longer knows because his iPhone is now in three pieces.
Just a second, I need a drink.
Okay. Hey, what's in this? you just made him break the word of wisdom.
Smooth!
So, I always think it's important when folks come to something like this and there's a specific topic mentioned, I always feel badly if they come up to me afterwards and said, I really wish you had gotten around to the topic at some point in time. So we have been talking a little bit about Jesus. We've already talked about some of the key issues as far as how we define these things and the range of beliefs of Mormons. But let's try to... Maybe I could give my strongest argument and you respond to it and see if it goes, if it always goes back to authority or if it goes back to an exegetical issue where we could actually get into the text. Because would you say, well, and now I'm going to contradict myself. Would you say that we can look at what the New Testament says about Jesus and come to sound conclusions, or is the New Testament just completely unreliable at that point?
I think that the conclusions have a fundamental presupposition from your perspective that is incompatible with my presuppositions.
Most definitely.
Yeah.
I. But again, it goes to authority. It goes to the source of authority.
Not necessarily. Well, it could be. I mean, there are... you and I have talked about the meaning of Greek words. And you have a certain perspective. I have found other Greek scholars who have a different perspective than you do. So what do we say? We just throw it up and say, you are right or he is right. Both of you make a good case for it. And at some point, we make a decision to say, well, this is what I'm more comfortable with, or this is what I'm more comfortable with.
I'm not sure. It would be nice to have an example that would be relevant to this particular subject or any example at all, but I have a feeling in most of those situations we're talking about the difference between believing that the New Testament is a consistent body of revelation or approaching it as if it is a scattered and self-contradictory body.
No, because I think you and I are both in the camp of believing that it is a consistent, what was the other terms you gave?
Self-consistent, reliable.
It's a self-consistent, reliable guide to our faith. But... having said that, I would also say that Mormonism would not be any different if we did not have the Bible.
That's exactly what LeGrand Richards said.
Uh-huh. And that we go to the Bible to say, this shows that what we believe is consistent.
You know, it's interesting to me. I really believe that if you look carefully at the Book of Mormon, Dr. Curtis Pilgrim Price, the assumption of the author... It assumes the preexistence of the Christian scriptures.
Sure.
I really think it does.
Say that again?
It assumes that the reader has the Christian scriptures in mind.
Absolutely.
So how can you say that it wouldn't change anything if you got rid of those, the very foundation that makes your documents even semi-interpretational?
Because it isn't the foundation of our doctrine.
But by saying that, you're saying that your written scriptures aren't the foundation of your doctrine either.
No. I'm saying that our written scriptures are the foundation of our doctrine, but if you were to take the Bible out of that foundation, it wouldn't change.
Okay, and what I'm trying to say is, if the Book of Mormon, Dr. Curtis Pilgrim Price, assumes that the reader has the background of the Christian scriptures at hand, without that, they would not be able to be interpreted or understood.
I don't agree with that.
Okay. All right. So when we come to Jesus,
amen.
What does... I just gave an invitation and he responded. when we come to Jesus, we had a discussion about this. Let me ask you something. The changes in the Book of Mormon in regards to what seems to me to be an early implicit modalism in the Book of Mormon... from God to Son of God. You know what I'm talking
about,
those changes.
I do, and I disagree. I don't think it's modalistic.
You don't see any...
how it can be interpreted that way, but there are a couple of passages in those particular passages that that absolutely deny the perspective of modalism.
Well, I would agree. I don't
Does everybody know what we're talking about when we say modalism? Okay.
We're talking about, as I read the changes in the Book of Mormon, it is very common for Christians who are not trained in theology to adopt a modalistic perspective. Even when I first started studying Mormonism, there were Christians in my own church where I would ask them questions, and they gave me modalistic answers because they had not
really... Those are the ones I was referring to when we were talking about the Trinity.
But as I said, they are individuals who had never done any study on the subject. I can't see how you
could
possibly...
And those are the people I was talking about at the Day of Pentecost, who had never done any study,
But they had apostles that they then were instructed by. So there's a little bit of a difference there. We're talking here about people who have access to information, but they don't access it. And unfortunately, that is a problem in all the world's religions. I think there's something called, what do you call the Mormons down south? They're Mormons, but they're not really serious about their faith.
People at BYU?
No,
I'm just trying to see what's clear here. No.
Please, if you throw anything, aim well, okay? I'm fairly close. I can't get out of the way all that quickly. But the point being that modalism is the idea that many Christians will look at something like John chapter 14, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father, and therefore they put the Father and the Son together as if they're one person.
They believe that the Godhead exists in separate modes, that the Father became the Son and then the Son became the Holy Ghost. There are some...
there are variations
now,
of that.
You probably wouldn't call them Christians, but I do. Christian sects that are modalists, Oneness Pentecostals, they do not believe that the Father exists anymore, that he is now the Holy Spirit, and that before that he was Jesus Christ.
Sort
now that's a rough and dirty description of
that's
of
very
modalism.
Rough because I've debated the folks that they actually believe Jesus was two persons.
Yeah,
the Son is not an eternal person. He was indwelt by the Father. The Son came into existence at a point in time.
Yes.
But the point is, there's only one person in the Godhead that sometimes acts like the Father, Son, or Spirit, something like that. Here's the point. I see the possibility that that was Joseph's misunderstanding, and I don't see evidence. In the same way, when I look at the Quran, I don't see that Muhammad had a proper understanding of the doctrine of the Trinity, even though it had been clearly defined by that point. I don't see the same thing in the Book of Mormon.
Okay, let me give you an example. In the 15th chapter of Mosiah, Abinadi says, "I would that ye should understand that God himself shall come down among the children of men and shall redeem his people. And because he dwelleth in flesh, he shall be called the Son of God." And then it talks about his conception, and it says, because of his conception, he shall be called the Father and the Son, thus becoming the Father and Son. As a result of his conception, he became the Father as well as the Son. And that's Mosiah chapter 15. A lot of people gloss over that, and they don't see it.
And if someone gave me that answer on a theology test at seminary, I'd fail them.
Uh-huh. That's because they're not Mormons.
Well, that's exactly right. But the point is that that's not an accurate understanding of even what was taught in that day. And so I don't see a meaningful interaction on the part of LDS scriptures with orthodox Christian theology,
well,
the doctrine of the Trinity.
There isn't.
Why wouldn't there be?
Because it's false.
But if it's meant to give you, if it's meant to respond to that, I mean, in light of the first vision, if...
Well, I may have lost you here.
Okay. If the first vision, and I'm not sure how you view the first vision. Do you believe that there was an evolution of that story, or do you believe that what Joseph Smith saw in the spring of 1820 was two separate distinct individuals?
I believe that he saw two separate and distinct individuals, but I don't believe that he described it that way each time he gave the story.
That's we would certainly agree on that point. But if that is foundational, that comes before the Book of Mormon, Doctrine and Covenants, Pearl of Great Price, chronologically, right?
No.
1820?
1832. His first description.
Right, but the experience comes before all of that.
Sure.
So if in the giving of those scriptures, you have the substantiation of why all those religions are wrong, why wouldn't you have an interaction with it? Why wouldn't you have a meaningful explanation of where all these churches have gone wrong in all this literature that comes afterwards?
Because I don't think that's the purpose of the Book of Mormon.
Well, not even
the Book of Mormon is not designed to...
Doctrine and Covenants, then.
Okay. Eventually, it has a pretty good description.
Where?
It's 130th section, where it talks about the Father being a personage and separate and distinct from the Son and the Holy Spirit.
Okay, but there's no real interaction with the Christian understanding of these things.
So?
I would think that if, in light of the situation of the early church, all the debates they were doing, that there would be a clear explanation of why what I believe and what Christians believe is allegedly wrong.
And I don't think that's the perspective of Latter-day Saints. Okay. We don't go out and say, what you believe is wrong. That is not the premise of our missionary effort. Our missionary effort goes out and says, what you have, much of what you have is true. We don't expect you to get rid of what you have is what is true. Keep that with you. Come in and join with us and learn a fuller understanding of what's true.
But the fundamental places where we disagree with one another are not places where you can add something to it without fundamentally changing it.
It's true. And I think what happens is if you come to a realization that Joseph Smith was a prophet and that the Book of Mormon is true, all those other doctrines will settle in and become inconsequential.
Well, settle in means you will have to abandon
the
very core of what your confession has always been, especially when you say, when we say that there is one true and eternal God who has always been God, will always be God, and does not depend upon anything other than himself who created all things. I mean, this is a fundamental dividing line that then defines why the Jesus, and we haven't even gotten into issues of blood atonement, and it would have been interesting to get into. Well, I will ask you a question. Do you think the issue of Jesus' conception is a dogmatic teaching or a speculative teaching on the part of the LDS Church?
I think it depends on what you say about his conception.
That he was, well, wait a minute, I just realized I wasn't trying to trick you here. You're the one that explained to me that this is absolutely definitional, because if the Father was not his Father, literally, he would not have had the power of eternal life.
Correct.
So, in my experience, once again, many Mormons not only do not know that teaching, I've had many Mormons reject that teaching and call it blasphemous in my presence. Why?
I think you're assuming too much there.
Assuming too much regarding what?
When you say literally the Father.
In the way that Bruce R. McConkie explained it. Well, not just Bruce R. McConkie, but all the way back, everyone, I don't know if you've read my book, but I included an entire chapter in response to some farms materials that basically said this has never been taught. And I demonstrated that from the very beginning, the apostles and prophets, all the way through a modern handbook of the church published by the Corporation of the First Presidency, showing that the fact that God the Father in a physical body was the Father of the Son, which is why he had the ability to be resurrected and have eternal life.
No problem with that. But you also have to realize that the LDS teachings found in our scriptures say that after Christ was born, Mary was still a virgin.
Right. So how do you put those two together?
For me, it's a mystery. I don't understand it. But I do know that the LDS doctrine is that Jesus is the Son of the Father.
And that's in the flesh.
Yeah. In fact, even John said that if you don't believe that Jesus is come in the flesh, it's anathema.
But do you think Brigham Young was saying the same thing? His sermons seem really,
yeah,
really clear to me.
They seem really, really clear, but at the same time, those sermons were never published by the church.
So, it comes back to authority again at this point.
Now, maybe some of you aren't aware that the Journal of Discourses has never been published by the LDS Church.
I'm aware of that, but I also am aware of the fact that when you look at And again, from my perspective, if it's got the Corporation of the Presidency of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints on it, that means that the current leadership says, this is what we believe.
Yeah.
And when I read in the eternal marriage ceremony, in the marriage preparation manual from just a few years ago, the citations that are given from Talmadge and others, and also from sermons from Brigham Young. There's a selectivity, it's a selectivity.
Well,
there. I guess we can't hold anybody accountable for that?
No, we've been over this in our correspondence. And
that correspondence was a long time ago.
It was. You cited James Talmadge. James Talmadge, who said that the Father was the Father of Christ,
in such a way that we do not understand, not in contravention of natural law, but in fulfillment of natural law, but then still pointing out that is something we don't understand. I do not understand how Jesus can literally be the Son of the Father and the mother be a virgin after the baby is born. I don't understand how that works, but I believe that is the teaching of our church.
And yet, okay, so again, we go back to authority because I read Brigham Young mocking the Christian doctrine of the virgin, and I mean mocking with.
I'm familiar with those comments, and he was mocking from the perspective of saying, well, you know, let's be careful not to give women the gift of the Holy Ghost lest they conceive and have children.
Right. Which was a mockery of his understanding of the Christian church, which I don't think was a very accurate understanding of Christian theology. But and obviously from an outsider's perspective, if it is through him that is traced the priesthood authority, you see the issues here? I mean, did he not have an understanding of these things? It causes problems that I didn't have in talking to the missionaries 30 years ago. They didn't argue this way. They were saying, yes, that's exactly what the church teaches. That's exactly why we're the one true church.
But you and I had this disagreement 30 years ago.
There was a difference.
We're in the same situation that we were 30 years ago. My perspective has not changed, and I can't be held accountable for the ignorance of missionaries that have met with you.
But where did they get that stuff from?
Good question.
They
have access to the same doctrines and historical documents that I have. I'm familiar with it.
It seemed a lot of them had read Bruce R. McConkie and sort of took him seriously.
Hey, I read Bruce R. McConkie. I take him seriously.
And yet at times have to go, I'm not going there.
Let me tell you an example Eldon Watson had. A friend of ours, we'll use the term loosely.
I'm not sure he'd use that term, but anyway. But
Bruce R. McConkie wrote a letter to Eugene England, and he was fairly forceful in what he claimed Brigham Young taught, and the anti-Mormons got a hold of it, and they passed it out at every temple dedication you ever came across. And Eldon was on a committee. His calling was as a doctrinal specialist of the church, to talk to people who got into doctrinal problems, who did not find satisfaction with their bishop or their stake president. And he talked to Bruce R. McConkie about this, and he said, you know, this letter is problematic for us. And he said, I sent it out, and I regret it now, and you can tell anybody that asks you that I was wrong.
About the letter.
About the letter.
Did he ever say that about his book?
Huh? No, he didn't say it in his book, and I don't think there was any need to do that personally. He changed things in his book, Mormon Doctrine, as he came to understand things differently. That's not a problem. I think it's possible. I think you're arguing from the perspective that if you are a Latter-day Saint or a Latter-day Saint general authority, you can't have any mistaken notions about anything. And you can. In fact, let me give you a quote from Brigham Young.
I think the issue really is how many times we have been told that the reason that you should consider Mormonism is, unlike all you Christians, they're just stuck with the dead letter of the book and you're all just interpreting different ways. We have the living voice of the prophet, and yet what I'm hearing over and over again is, yes, but there's a super limitation on that, and we will not be held accountable for things that were taught by apostles and prophets for generation after generation after generation, just because,
generation after generation after generation. My grandfather heard Brigham Young speak.
Okay, well, then they may live for a long time, but yeah. The point is that there has been a consistency in the teaching over time.
Let me give you a concept that Brigham Young taught on more than one occasion.
Let me ask really quickly here.
Okay.
Really?
He said,
wow, this last time period is going really slow.
I am so far from believing that any government upon this earth has constitutions and laws that are perfect that I do not even believe that there is a single revelation among the many God has given to the church that is perfect in its fullness. The revelations of God contain correct doctrine and principle so far as they go, but it is impossible for the poor, weak, low, groveling, sinful inhabitants of the earth to receive a revelation from the Almighty in all of its perfections. He classed himself among those people. He did not believe that his perception of doctrine was perfect.
It seems a little bit contradictory to the incredible condemnations they made of the other churches in light of that.
Yeah, that's. I think that's perhaps because you get a skewed view of it. I have read lots of Brigham Young's discourses that far exceed what you find in the Journal of Discourses, and I don't see him spending that much time condemning the Christian churches.
He did.
Well, he did. He had an axe to grind. He was upset. He lost his home 7 different times, and many times at the insistence of sectarian Christian ministers.
But the doctrinal issues.
Doctrinal issues.
That's the only thing I'm concerned about. I mean, he did condemn.
He condemned their perspective of sin, their perspective of God, their perspective of man, their perspective of basically some of the things that I outlined there. We do have some very significant differences that are incompatible with Trinitarian Christianity. No question about it. And if you finally come to a realization of the truth, you'll cede those away.
And obviously, from my perspective, what you would be asking of any Christian in the audience in looking at Jesus would be to adopt a view of Jesus that would require us to abandon what?
I would
How about atonement?
No, atonement's there. I would say...
In the same way?
No. We believe things that are above and beyond what you believe about the atonement. We believe that it had a twofold nature, that it occurred twice, that it occurred in the Garden of Gethsemane, in the garden and on the cross.
Twice or one process fulfilled in two different places?
I believe it occurred twice. And I think Bruce R. McConkie teaches that Christ died for our sins, that he paid the penalty for our sins, both for spiritual death and for physical death. And that occurred in two places. And there's a binary nature of LDS theology that I think you would eventually embrace.
So the cross wasn't necessary. It had already been paid.
Oh, no. It was as essential.
How can it be paid twice?
It's an infinite atonement. And as I understand it, here I am. This is Alma, not Alma Book of Mormon, but Alma Allred, is that the atonement performed by Christ took care of two problems. It took care of death and sin. And he paid for our sins first, and he paid for the transgression of Adam on the cross. And both of those were infinite in their severity. And that's why we have the bread and the wine, or the bread and the water, why there is a binary nature to much of the doctrine of the restored gospel of Jesus Christ.
And that is clearly something unknown in the New Testament.
Not necessarily. We're told that Christ was in agony in the Garden of Gethsemane, and that he bled through every pore. The blood that he shed in the Garden of Gethsemane came down as great gouts of blood.
But there's nothing in Luke, and there's never anything in Paul, there's nothing in Hebrews which expands upon this fully.
You're
that
right.
Gives even the slightest indication, and there's nothing in early church history.
That's right.
That would substantiate any of that concept
at
all.
Except for that one passage. Is it in Luke?
It's in Luke.
Yeah, in Luke.
Where nothing is mentioned about atonement, nothing is mentioned about forgiveness, and yet...
No.
But as I said, there are a lot of things that we believe that exceed what is taught in the Bible. No question about it.
See, I want to challenge the term exceed because, see, as I look at our doctrine of the atonement from the New Testament, it is always, the issue is not location. It is the freely given life of the Son of God in behalf of his people that propitiates the wrath of a holy God against sinners. And so it actually, there is a union of God's people with Christ so that his death becomes their death, his burial, their burial, his resurrection, their resurrection. And so there is perfect unity between Father, Son, and Spirit in bringing about the salvation of these people. And that perfect work of atonement upon the cross is what absolutely centralizes the gospel in what God does and not what I do. It has nothing to do with my exaltation. It has everything to do with my redemption as a creature, not in my becoming a God, but my coming to have absolute perfect peace with God. And okay. all my worthiness after that only flows from the work of the grace of God within me. It has nothing to do in adding to anything that Christ has done whatsoever.
Well, I think if you expect me to respond to that, you have taken a bit of license about what we believe.
What do you mean?
Well, I cannot add to his sacrifice. In the Book of Mormon, Lehi talks to his son Jacob, and he says, I know that you are redeemed because of the righteousness of thy Redeemer. It was the righteousness of Christ that redeemed Joseph. It is the righteousness of Christ, his merits, his mercy, that we are required to rely upon. We're not adding to his sacrifice. We're not adding to his atonement. And when you suggest that we believe that we are, you are mistaken about LDS doctrine.
But if you say that that has been undertaken for every single human being, and yet they are not exalted, there's obviously something more.
Correct.
And it involves continued obedience to gospel ordinances and principles, doesn't it?
It includes obedience to God. And as the author of Hebrews pointed out, that Christ is become the author of eternal salvation to them that obey him. It isn't merely believers who are saved, it is obedient believers.
But I just finished preaching through Hebrews for a number of years.
Whether you preach it or not, you have to consider Hebrews 5:9 that says that it's obedient believers.
And I do. The problem is I will not allow the author of the Hebrews to contradict himself, because his point is not that my obedience adds to the work of Christ or makes the work of Christ acceptable or workable or effective or anything else. The point is, when it says obey him, that's the same people who in chapter 7 are those who draw near to God through him. Those are individuals whose hearts have been changed by the Spirit of God. It's not a matter of my obedience actuating the work of Christ.
No,
because
the work
you're
of
telling
Christ
me
is complete.
That there are people who are redeemed but who will not be exalted.
Sure.
And the difference is what they do. The intention of the atonement of Christ has never been for exaltation. From my perspective.
And we would disagree with that. I would say that the entire purpose of the atonement of Jesus Christ is the eternal life and exaltation of mankind. That's why he came. He came to bring us into the same position that he is in.
And biblically, you cannot possibly establish from the context of the New Testament or even the early church. That's what the apostles taught. That is a eisegetical insertion upon the text from 1,800 years later,
but
which
still, it's not,
makes
it's
it
not
backwards.
Incompatible.
It's fundamentally incompatible.
It's fundamentally incompatible from your Calvinist perspective. It isn't fundamentally incompatible with an Arminian.
Oh, no, I will even defend my Arminian brothers at this point. The Arminians in the audience are agreeing with me at that point. Because while the Arminian and the Calvinist are going to have a major discussion about the intention of the atonement in regards to scope, they are not going to have an argument as to what the intention of the atonement was in regards to exaltation, because that is simply not a category that has any meaning to the New Testament.
That's right. It isn't treated in the New Testament. We don't believe that all doctrine is encapsulated in there.
And yet Peter said everything that we need for life and godliness has been given to us. Not something that's
going to
depend upon for 1,800
years
later.
I don't understand it as you do. Well, of course, Peter also said that that the Lord will make us partakers of His divine
nature. Yes, He did.
Nature.
And that never had anything to do with the plurality of gods.
Yeah, from your perspective.
Well, I would simply argue that from the New Testament perspective, as it was written, and I would think that you would want the Book of Mormon to be interpreted within the context in which it was written, the Doctrine and Covenants within the context in which it was written, but I don't think you're doing that for the New Testament, but I'm getting audience question indication. Yes?
We're almost there.
Let's do the audience questions. I think I'd be, because we took a long, long break. It's already nearly 9 o'clock.
Sure. If I can have another drink.
How long are we going, Jason?
Just a few moments.
Okay. All right. I just didn't know what the time frame was.
If you have any questions, please submit them in writing. I apologize. I've been operating under cold medicine, and I love 3x5 cards on my desk.
Take a swig of this.
Pray for me on my drive. But at any rate, if you desperately need paper, you can use our card. It better be a good question if you use one of my cards. But at any rate,
you're just going to read them, or is there a possibility of just taking hands?
I found a long time ago it's better not to let people have the microphone, even if there isn't one.
I got one that's not being used.
Having three participants in the dialogue.
I understand, but writing out questions and collecting is going to take quite some time.
I have two that have been given to me already.
So okay.
I'll go ahead and ask the first one. We're not going to go through that many, so please make them quickly. The first question is from Mr. Allred. From the LDS perspective, was Jesus a God before creation, as well as His substitutionary atonement on the cross? Or were those works required of Him by God the Father to progress towards godhood and become a God of His own planet?
He was God before the world was created. Section 38 of the Doctrine and Covenants. I brought it just because I thought that question might come up. Let me see if I've got it here. This is from the Doctrine and Covenants. It says, "Thus saith the Lord your God, even Jesus Christ, the great I Am, Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the same which looked upon the wide expanse of eternity and all the seraphic hosts of heaven before the world was made, the same which knoweth all things, for all things are present before mine eyes. I am the same which spake, and the world was made, and all things came by me."
Could I ask a question? What's the date of that? Do you happen to know off the top of your head?
Section 38, probably 1831.
Okay. Again, let me do a Bart Ehrman.
Okay.
There's clear evolution after that. How do we know?
Clear evolution after that, away from that concept? Jesus Christ was the creator of the heavens and the earth?
There's clear evolution in the sense of the development of the priesthood concept, and I think within the plurality of gods as well.
But it doesn't change any of that perspective.
My only point being that I do see in the Book of Mormon a strong emphasis upon those things from what I see as a modalistic perspective. Mm-hmm. Is there any possibility that 10 years from now we'll be talking about major works of LDS theology that have come out that raise questions about the possibility of this very issue of evolution and what that might mean?
No.
No possibility at all?
No.
What if that were to happen? Theoretically, what would you do as a faithful Mormon?
I would be surprised, but I don't like working with hypotheticals. It's like someone to say, what would you do if the prophet said, okay, same-sex marriage is okay? I don't see that as happening. And I don't like treating it as a hypothetical because I don't think it's possible. I don't think it's possible.
You don't think it's possible?
No.
This is Utah we're talking about.
Yeah. Yeah. Who probably will vote for Clinton.
You've seen one of our senatorial candidates. The next question is for Dr. White. What is the King Follett doctrine and how is it in contradiction to Colossians 1:5? I'm 1:15.
Well, I'm not sure there's a King Follett doctrine. There's a King Follett discourse, which we were discussing earlier, and Alma raised some questions regarding the accuracy of it. But as far as I know, it's the most often repeated sermon of Joseph Smith. It is found in the teachings of Prophet Joseph Smith. It's found in a number of different sources. And it is, I think, one of the clearest explications of the final doctrine, because it was only, what, 2 months?
2 months before he was killed.
2 months before he was killed. So I think it is, I think if you were to ask someone what is the final mature theology of Joseph Smith in regards to exaltation, you'd be hard-pressed to find anything that came after that that is as full as the sermon delivered at the death of King Follett, who unfortunately was crushed while digging a well by a tub of rock, which is not a good way to go, personally. But anyway, its teaching is fundamentally that God was, well, he says, first principle of the gospel. No, that God was once a man. He lays out the principle of exaltation, the principle of really, it's almost like a, I've described it as a train. You know, you have these generations connected to one another, and they're moving toward exaltation and so on and so forth. It's not, in my opinion, an overly well-crafted sermon. It's some sort of jumps around a little bit. Why do I believe it's contradictory to Colossians 1:15? Well, there's a fundamental theological issue in regards to the fact that a biblical monotheist who believes there's one God who created all things is going to have a hard time with the idea that God is once a man who lived on another planet, because that raises...
Can I pause just for a second? Because the King Follett discourse does not require that it was a God who lived on another planet. The concepts that he taught in the King Follett discourse could equally apply to Christ, that God himself, i.e. Christ, was once a man.
Except he does connect it to our experience.
Yeah.
He doesn't say it was a unique experience where you have a Messiah-like figure. And how many Mormons are the Messiahs? They're not.
No.
So I don't think it would have made application to the people he was preaching to interpret it in that way. And you'd have to admit, majority of the apostles and prophets of the Mormon Church have addressed it, have interpreted it the same
sure.
way I did.
I interpret it as well.
Okay. Well, there we go. So,
I'm going to squeeze in two more questions.
You look like you're about to fall over, Jason. I'm a little bit concerned about you.
I'm always pale.
Sometimes you have to get out with that big glowing thing in the sky. It's a good thing.
Turn red.
Well, that's true.
What's wrong with being all red?
Oh.
Oh,
I see.
Anyway, this one's for Mr. Allred. The God of the Bible claims there is none like him in heaven or in earth. He claims to have created everything that is in existence. A plurality of gods makes those claims a lie. Define if all these gods are equal and if they share the universe, or is there one above all?
Well, we don't know a lot about the other gods of existence other than the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. They are not equal. So, you know, I don't know if I could expand beyond that, because we don't know. I mean, Christ said, "My Father is greater than I." Now, I know you have a different perspective of that, perhaps thinking of it as his...
Well, the context
his incarnation, but from my perspective, the Father supersedes the Son, and that I expect, hypothetically, if I enter into exaltation and become a God, I would always be subject to my Father and my God, and I would be subject to Christ, who took on a new role as a result of the atonement.
And I think your follow-up is tied up in the question for you, Dr. White. This is coming from an LDS perspective. In the Bible, Christ says that he can only do the will of the Father. In another section, he says that he cannot speak of himself. If he speaks of God, how is he also God?
Yeah, that seems to be a reference to John chapter 5. The point of John chapter 5, when Jesus says, I do nothing of myself, apheiotu, the Son does nothing of himself. There is a perfect unity that exists between the Father and the Son and what they accomplish and what they do. Jesus is not some deity out there running roughshod and doing his own thing. And he has voluntarily, and this is very important in Philippians chapter 2, it says he made himself of no reputation. It was not he was made of no reputation. He voluntarily entered into human flesh. And as such, he has submitted himself to the will of the Father to accomplish what? John chapter 6. I've come down out of heaven not to do my own will, but the will of him who sent me. What is the will of him who sent me? That all that he has given me, I lose none of them that raised him up on the last day. That is his glory, is that he is the one who brings perfect salvation to his people. And so what you're looking at is what's called the economic or functional Trinity. It is the roles the Father, Son, and Spirit chose to take in eternity past in bringing about the redemption of God's people, which is the greatest glorification of the triune God. It's what God chose to do from eternity past. The relationship between Father, Son, and Spirit in eternity past happens to be an issue of controversy even to our day in making sure that we remain within biblical parameters. And I think one of the issues that we're dealing with today is the fact that biblical parameters, when they're expanded out to a larger canon, are no longer really even discernible and usable. It's okay. Everyone was watching you. You're now you are now all red as well. So
please join me in thanking our two speakers this evening.
Thank you, Alma.
It was fun.
Appreciate it. Thank you. Feel better, Jason.
Thank you.